It wasn't until he came home this particular Saturday, he was staying over till Sunday, and of course prepared his favourite lamb chops and you name it, you know, and shock horror, I don't eat that sort of thing. And I said, but you love lamb chops, because I was ignorant in those days as well. Anyway, then he told me he'd met this group of people who were interested in animals and their welfare, and they didn't eat meat because, as Keith said to me at that time, animals are there in their own right. They're not there for us to kill and to torture and then to eat. And he had seen, obviously, evidence of the cruelty involved in this, and so no longer would he eat meat. And then he started his lecture that we shouldn't do it and whatever. Now, I did agree with him, but his dad said, sort of, well, I've eaten it all my life and I'm not going to stop now, because that's what these animals are there for. Anyway, the easiest way for me was to go along and still eat the meat myself, but I always had a conscience after that. And it wasn't until Keith was actually in prison that I realised that what I'm doing is wrong. Ignorance is no excuse.
When I was younger, there was this rabbit I used to see on my way to school, penned in a tiny cage in a backyard with nothing, no quality of life, no companionship, nothing. He never seemed to have any decent food. He wasn't even let out for exercise, he just sat there. I pushed a note one day through the letterbox of its owner, asking him to pay some attention to the rabbit. They ignored me and they ignored the rabbit, so I tried again. This time I warned them that if they didn't do something, I would. They didn't do anything, so one night I snuck out with a hold all and took the rabbit. His quality of life improved overnight, and he went on to enjoy a long and happy one. Direct action worked for that rabbit where nothing else did.
Keith has been through a certain process. He's seen some of the things that I've seen. He's seen the slaughterhouses. He's seen the real face of hunting. He's been inside laboratories. He's watched videos about badger baiters, and he's rubbed shoulders with these people that me and him would both conclude are utter filth.
Keith and Angie are very caring, sensitive people. They're dedicated to the fight for animal liberation. On the whole, very caring, sensitive people.
Why did you do it? There are lots of organisations that have tried to do something about factory farming in this country for a lot of years. There are now, at the back end of the 20th century, literally millions of birds in this country being kept confined in cages with no more space than an A4 sheet of paper. We weren't out to harm anyone, we never did. It's not a policy of the Animal Liberation Fund to harm life, it protects life, that's why the Animal Liberation Fund exists. Economic sabotage is the only way to have an impact on the people responsible for all this suffering. People pretend it doesn't happen, they're not concerned. They're not interested in what's happening in Australia. It's not their responsibility.
What would make a young man like Keith do something like this? He's petitioned. He's asked. He's demonstrated. He's done all sorts of things to ask these people not to do this.
We wanted to do something physical to stop them doing what they were doing to the birds. It was hurting us. The only alternative we had, we could have walked away. That was what we wanted to do. We didn't want to sit there and watch what was happening. But too many people walk away, which is part of the problem, part of the reason why it's happening. We saw the lorries. We thought we'll burn the lorries. That'll stop them doing what they're doing to the birds tonight. It'll also cost them a fair few pounds and make them think maybe about what they're doing. At the end of it, we were just so sickened by what we were seeing. what these evil bastards are doing to the birds. It's in our pockets, we're burning them anyway. Sorry, we're not going anywhere. We've got to do something about it tonight. We can't just leave these birds.
When Keith was on remand, he was in 19 different either prisons or police stations, 19 in 18 months. And this, doing a tour of the country, was to make sure that he never got a chance to study his depositions, to prepare his own defence for when the trial ever did come to be. So when I say he went to hell, and he certainly didn't come back until he escaped.
That's the performing dog.
When I escaped, I met up with Angela Hamp, who she was also on the run at the time. We went to work on an animal sanctuary, spent our time there looking after the animals. That's all we were concerned with.
When I first met Keith and Angie, a few months before they were arrested at the sanctuary, when they applied for a job, we were advertising for voluntary help at the sanctuary. They applied, they came to see me. I liked them both instantly. They were obviously very dedicated and genuine people, and we said more or less there and then, yes, we'd like you to come and help us. I didn't have any idea when they came to us that they were on the run from the police, no idea at all. I couldn't possibly have put the charity at risk. And because by having them there, knowingly, that's what I would have done. We were raided by the police in April last year, about 6 o'clock in the morning. I'd only gone to bed at four, having been out rescuing animals in London. And it seemed I just shut my eyes to go to sleep when all hell broke loose. Banging, smashing, breaking glass, dogs barking, men shouting. To be honest, I thought someone had come to kill us all. Just had to stop climbing up the stairs. I didn't have my glasses on, so I couldn't see who it was. I'd come to my senses that it was actually the police. And it was a completely unbelievable situation. I couldn't imagine what was going on. We were all taken downstairs to the kitchen and were told we'd all be arrested and taken to the police station.
Don't they ask themselves, what would make a young man like Keith or like Keith's friends, what would make them do something like this? Okay, you know, to normal people, they're going to say, well, he'd no right to touch somebody else's property. You know, that's somebody else's property, nothing to do with him. But frustration comes in here. He's petitioned, he's asked, he's demonstrated, he's done all sorts of things to ask these people not to do this. They should stop and think, there's got to be another reason why he's gone so far. If they were to speak to my son now, ask him, what did he see behind these locked doors that patrolled by guards and dogs? What did he see that would make him so angry that he would have to go so far and destroy somebody's property?